Hey, this is GT with another YouTube video, and today I just wanted to perhaps dictate a few notes in my head, if nothing else, and save a place in my mind and in the record for my thoughts and my leadings or what have you. But I awoke this morning with a thought, which was somewhat disturbing and revelatory. The thought of a currency. Globalized currency, let's say, for example, if it were something that was not done as a reaction to some kind of a chaotic emergency of some kind. That if it were organized and done and agreed upon by, let's say, the rest of the world, or like in a nation, UN type of a committee or what have you, and this is how they do their thing by committee and all that. But okay, specifically what I was trying to what I'm trying to get at is with regards to a global currency, let's say one based upon, as they have been saying, or and if you read anything about it, they want to do a new global currency based upon a basket of currencies, and or really they're trying to get away from currencies altogether, and there are currency wars happening, so it would probably make it difficult to do it on a basket of currencies in a realistic manner. However, if they used it as based upon a commodity markets and commodity availability and all that and prices, then it would be global and it would be more realistic and more fair, I would assume, based upon the value of things that are made, like food and metals and whatever, things that are made to make things, the basics, the very basics. So these are realistic money or modes of as a basis for exchange rather than gold, which I don't think will ever be used as a basis again, simply because there's just no way to value it based upon the trillions and trillions and trillions of dollars that have been printed and exist, on paper because of that, and all the loans, and if you supposedly only like 3 to 5% of the actual cash, quote unquote, that is around is even on paper, not on papers per se, but printed. Okay, so most of it is actually just zeros and ones, digital. If you go back and look at any of my videos on money and currency and finance and banking and all that, you understand that the whole concept of money, quote unquote, as we conceive of it today, is you know, it's a fantasy, and that it has any value, no. And you could wipe your rear end with it after you, you know, expelled some feces. You know, probably good for that if you crumbled up. But so virtually worthless. Okay, but that is my point of today, is that, you know, the US dollar, okay, now if one looks at this as in a biblical perspective and from a symbolically biblical perspective, that the beast, okay, now there are, I don't want to get ahead of myself. Now, the second beast is purported to be the basically the U.S. and or Britain, England, U.K., whatever you want to call it. But I think of it more along the lines of Britain or UK being the, you know, and I've talked about the tripartite government of the world, or, you know, whatever, being a financial component being in the UK, the City of London with their obelisk and what have you, and the United States of America, now known as the United States, the corporation, you know, as the military and or social arm of that system, and then the Roman Catholic Church being the religious and or, well, basically the religious center or the religious system, which and of course they're all intertwined and en masse, so that, you know, they're hard to tease apart and all that. But but in the context of biblical prophecy, there are mentions of the 10 kingdoms or the 10 horns or what have you. Was it horns or heads? I don't know. Anyway, that the powers of the earth give their powers to the harlot or the whore or whatever that rides the beast, okay, and they are given their, so the whore, the harlot, whatever, is there by their will and by their permission, or, you know, relatively speaking. And then later it says that they hate the whore, the harlot, whatever, the one that they gave the power to lead them and to move them around and whatever. And they destroyed her. Okay. Now, I'm just getting this into, you know, I'm trying to wrap my head around the whole, all the implications and all that. So I haven't done any really in-depth re-researching about this such things and all that. But that those mentions and how the powers basically rebelled from the harlot and destroyed her made me think about that, and yeah, When you think about it, since World War II had ended, for the most part, the US dollar has been the reserve currency of the entire world. And, there have been certain agreements made throughout the past generation or so that were intended to keep the dollar as the reserve currency. And so if one were looking strictly at a financial from the financial realm or within the financial realm or perspective, then one would see that the world has given the power of the purse to the United States since just post-World War, actually. And then again, with the petrodollar system, which was agreed to, I believe, in 70, was it 73 or 75, between Saudi Arabia and the US, and then in turn all the other oil producing nations in the Middle Eastern area. Now, since then, a lot of changes have gone on, political, cultural, religious, etc. And, there's been quite a bit of going away from the system of petrodollar. And I talked about this in a video some time ago. Well, and since then, there's been a lot, there's been a dumping of the dollar. Basically, they're getting ready to, change or switch. There's preparatory movements in the financial and worldwide, the conventions of the world, agreements being made between countries and or corporations, however you want to say it. Think of them, but it's kind of like the US has been the CEO of the world for some time and had the power as both as it was voted in and given power by the rest of the board. And I believe that could be easily the United States in a way to just push it out of the world theater and get it, basically get rid of it in a day. Would just be to drop the currency. No longer use the dollar as the reserve currency. And its value would drop to zero, basically, overnight. The money, quote unquote, that we use, both internally and to trade with the world, would no longer be worth anything. Nothing, okay? And the panic and chaos that would ensue, it would basically, destroy the beast, the head of the beast, wouldn't it? And without anyone firing a shot, without a war per se, without nuclear weapons drops or anyone trying to attempt to take over the country physically, or anything, you know. And then, you know, corporations or countries like China and such that hold trillions of dollars of debt, well, you know, they might want to come in and you know, take some property or something. Who knows? Who's going to stop them, you know? The citizenry would defend itself, I'm sure, if attacked and if they perceived even an international threat of invasion or whatever. Probably the last country that you would want to try to invade would be the Americans. As dumbed down and whatever as they are, they can be a formidable enemy, and you know, given the experience of the veterans and the people that they are now vilifying and labeling as extremists and all that, that's because they're afraid of them. It's all that stuff, the Christians that they're afraid of, that they call extremists, the veterans, the conservatives, all these people who don't think like in their politically correct social control system mindset, they fear those people, you know. And that's why they're on the extremist list, you know. And then, you know, there's worldwide stuff about fundamentalism and extremism and all that. It's really just aimed at Christians, you know. But Christians who just happen to be honorable and, you know, have many of which have served in wars and have experience, you know, with liberty and guns and all that. Well, you know, I don't want to go into that, the whole thing. But I'm just saying, you know, that the Ten Horns, or let's say the rest of the world, just decides they want to can their CEO, and they do. And by doing so, they destroy her, or they take her out of consideration for any other real position of authority or power in the system anymore. You understand? That's all it would take, is just simply, you know, making it a new currency. And then, you know, along with that goes the portions of the first seals and all that. Which, and in particular, that of the famine and sickness and all that, and you know, the correlation between war and sickness and famine is pretty high, you know. But there's mention of, you know, you know, the hyperinflation which will occur, you know, a measure of wheat for X and X amount and a measure of barley. Well, you're talking about, a little bit of wheat and a little bit of barley, okay? It's enough to maybe make, you know, a loaf of bread, you know, one person's food for one day, being the wage of a whole day. And that wouldn't be, of course, a well-balanced meal or anything, you know. It would give you enough energy probably to work, I don't know, But I'm just saying, you know, so it could go with that, you know, the hyperinflation, which would occur like in the Weimar Republic, or what is it, Zambia or Zimbabwe or whatever, like it's got multi-trillion dollar notes. The sad thing about that is that, you know, their system has been so bad for so long that they actually had time to print up those notes. You know, I'm sure that the notes cost more to make than their face value. Think about it. You know, but okay, so another thing that I was thinking was that, you know, okay, if, as I have discussed or, you know, suggested, the possibility that, you know, this tripartite government, you know, the US being with the reserve currency is not only the military head but also the financial head of that, because the UK is kind of subsumed underneath us, even though we came out, for the most part, we came out of her, you know, not all of us, you know, and yeah, but let's just say that, you know, that was the banking center and the power center. You know, because money is power. You see, you understand, money is power. I've been talking about money is power and all that, but that the money isn't worth anything. You see, now all of these corporate heads that are known as presidents and plutocrats and autocrats and dictators and whatever, I mean, they all know that the money isn't worth anything. Except us peasants who are deluded into thinking that it's of any value whatsoever, you know. Their final usurping and taking over of all the property, you know, all of the land, all of the businesses, all of the infrastructure, all that will happen. You know, and everybody can, you know, come in and suck off all of the you know, everything that has a mortgage on it basically will collapse. You understand? You know, because the banks will collapse and the government will basically collapse. There will be a bankrupt. I mean, you know, we will necessarily have to default on all of our debts because we won't have the money to do it, to repay, okay? Which might be the best thing in the world that could possibly happen. And, you know, although it may seem to be a curse, it may indeed actually be a blessing in disguise, a blessing of the Father. And let us pray that the good people of the United States of America, the real system, if they are knocked out of the, you know, the headship or whatever, that we gracefully recover over time, you know, or at least that we don't, you know, all die off and kill each other off by fighting about, you know, who's gonna get that loaf of bread, you know. But that's how it could get down to, you know, and the famine, the starvation mentioned in the, you know, the four horsemen and all that, and the hyperinflation and all that, The United States and even the entire Western world don't play much of a part in the biblical arena because it's really all about, centered upon the area of the old world and the establishment of the Father's holy kingdom or set apart kingdom, the promised land given to his promised people and all that, And so, although we may be part of or part and parcel of some of the movements and goings on and all that, it necessarily isn't necessarily, because you see there's another reason why the United States needs to be out of the way, because when there is an attack and an advancement towards Israel, and historically we have supported Israel, and it would be likely that we as a people and as a military power would be there and come to their aid, And I know that's been damaged by the current regime and all that, but overall I believe the people of the United States do support and are a blessing to Israel and have helped and supported it and them. Although there are thoughts or lines of reasoning and scriptural interpretations which suggest that the U.S. and Israel might split away, and that's not really the focus of this video.
It's 12 o'clock.
But my main thing that I wanted to focus on was that, the U.S. being in its unique role as the reserve currency holder and owner at this time, and it's rapidly devolving to, then when, and there have been calls from many countries, and there are plans for replacing the U.S. as reserve currency. See, I just want everyone to understand, we don't produce anything anymore. We give our paper to them and they give us goods. You see what I'm saying? Paper for goods. Paper for goods. That's what it is. That's all it is. Just paper or digital. It's fantasy. It's nothing for good. We're getting everything for free. Do you get it? Basically, we're trading fantasy for goods. Okay? When that ends, when those countries no longer need our dollars to buy oil or anything else in the world, then we're out of it. Not only are we the middlemen, we're the only ones who've been really profiting. Now, granted, we buy stuff from those countries, and that brings up another verse in the Bible. How they miss selling their goods to the beast, the harlot or whatever. Another area that is potentially the harlot, and another aspect that I wanted to explore briefly, very briefly, was that the harlot may be different in different aspects. For example, there may be, you know, a harlot who rides on the beast of the on the religious spectrum or spectra or whatever, okay? And there, you know, there may be 10 kingdoms in the Middle East who uphold, for example, the beast of Islam in Saudi Arabia, and Mecca may be the city in name or whatever, or representing them or what have you. And that may be, you know, what is emphasized in that particular passage or whatever, may be the religious whore, harlot, or whatever that rides the religious beast, you see. Another beast might be the military beast or the financial beast or the socio-cultural beast, you know. And so what I'm saying is there's different layers, and it may subsume, or they may represent other countries, other areas, other the EU, for example, might be thought of as, I don't know, because they're like, you know, they're certainly not the financial I don't know, I don't even know what you could call the EU now, because it's like, it's just a total mess, it's falling apart, and you know, but it is the historic home place of the Roman Catholic Church and all that, the harlot in that aspect. And Islam may be, in fact, the de facto representation of the harlot, the new harlot, or the revived harlot nation state. I don't know, you know, it just gets deeper and deeper. And given that, you know, it has been said and suggested that the Islamic faith was indeed simply a device of the Roman Catholic Church to eventually take over the Middle East and gain the prize of Jerusalem, which they failed to maintain after the Crusades and all that. Yeah. So there's a lot of depth there, but you know, I'm just saying that one easy way for one beast to get out of the way and destroyed by the one harlot who can be destroyed by the kingdoms that gave it power could be this particular instance of the United States being the de facto CEO, and a way to push us out of the world king-making scenario or whatever. I mean, out of the financial, out of the military, because without finances, we no longer have an army, we no longer can maintain an army and military forces all over the world, you know. And there isn't, you know, I mean, there's vacuum that will be quickly filled by Russians and Chinese, you know. And they're, coincidentally, you know, they work together on a whole lot of stuff, you know. And you know, think about it. All right, well, that's all I had to say for today. I just thought I'd put that out there, and hopefully, you know, this video gets is good enough to put out, and I'll be doing it. So, blessings of the Father be to you, all those viewers and listeners and or readers. Amen.